Beyonce, you co-wrote and produced all the stuff on Survivor. Was this the plan? Did you want to do that, or did that just fall into place that way?
Well, I actually co-wrote and produced on The Writings on the Wall and on the first album. The first album, I was too young. I didn't know that I was supposed to get percentages and credit for it. The second album was when I realized that I could produce with just us in the just us in the studio. We really didn't need anybody else. And by the third album is when I realized that I should be getting credit for it. And it's not anything that I planned. I didn't say I want to write this album. We just went in the studio, started writing, and Survivor was the result.
Is it hard to get a co-producer or producer credit on the album? And would you think it'd be a lot easier if you were a bloke, if you were a guy?
I think being a young woman, a young black woman, made it a lot harder. I think more so, well, I don't know if it was me being young or if it was me being a woman, but those two together and me being black just made it three times hard. I actually just won the Songwriter of the Year for ASCAP a couple months ago, which is a huge accomplishment for me, but I was the second woman ever to win that. Mm. Out of all of the ASCAP writers, which is ridiculous because there's so many women that are great. So it's definitely hard being a woman, but I'm very grateful that I got that opportunity, and I'm happy that I'm opening the doors to other female artists. And now just about every female artist is out, young artists, they're all writing their own songs, so it's really, really great.
But with the first one, Destiny's Child, the second one, The Writings on the Wall, the third one, Survivor, have you learned enough in terms of that kind of work in the studio to maybe take on other artists and to say, I will produce your album, or I will write songs for somebody's album, or have the confidence to be able to do it for somebody else?
No, not yet. You know, when I first got my publishing deal, I thought I wanted to write for other people, and I went in the studio and wrote a couple songs, and they were so personal, or it just had it sounded like Destiny's Child because that's who I'm used to writing for, and I had a hard time writing for other people. Then when I tried to take myself out of it and write for someone else, it just seemed stupid. Like everything I wrote just sounded dumb to myself. So I don't think I can ever do that unless I'm really, really close with the artist, or unless I really love them and it's more like a collaboration. I just feel like artists should write their own songs.
Yeah, but I mean, maybe some of the ones you wrote for Destiny's Child might have seemed to you stupid because you'd be the worst critic of your own work. But Kelly Michelle come along and say, listen, that's bloody great. Let's do this. That's fantastic. And you don't have that if you're doing it for other people, because you're not as close. So let's wait till you become close with somebody else and they might say, yeah, that's great, that could be a hit.
Well, that could happen. That could definitely happen. That's why I could work with my sister or maybe an artist that I'm really close with. But as far as being a producer and writing for just everybody, I really admire, I so admire like Missy and all of the other producers that just write songs for everybody. That takes so much courage and confidence, and I'm still growing, maybe one day, but I just don't think that's one thing that's not something that I have, you know.
Yeah, you make it sound like as though it is difficult enough to be female and black and all the rest in the industry. I mean, the Supremes, when you look back, or further back, Aretha, do you think they'd be two names you'd say they did an awful lot and doors are certainly open for me now that wouldn't have been open unless they'd opened them?
Oh, definitely. I admire the Supremes and Aretha Franklin and all of those great artists, you know, in the 70s and the 60s that opened the doors for us. You know, that's why I'm such a fan of them. And it's just beautiful what they've done, you know, the Supremes, what they did with the charts. And now we're able to get that opportunity. We're able to be played on all different stations.
Yeah.
And it's great that they opened the doors and now we're able to open doors for other people.
One of the things the Supremes did, which you've done as well, in fact, I think you might have been the very first all-female outfit from the States to debut directly at number one in the UK. The Supremes were hugely successful in the UK, mm-hmm. which actually helped with their fame back in America.
Mm-hmm.
So in one way, was getting to number one straight the first week of release something very special to you in the UK? Having done it in America, you think, maybe it'll only stay within these four walls, we'll never get outside of America, but that's good enough. But suddenly number one in the UK as well. Was that something special?
That's definitely special. We didn't expect ever to have this much international success. And now we're actually, You know, if you add up the record sales internationally and just in America, we're bigger internationally than we are in America. So that's just a whole nother world. It's a whole nother world outside of America. It's beautiful. We're able to travel and see these beautiful places and meet these people and see these different cultures. And they're able to accept our music, and we're able to perform at Wembley, and we're able to perform in Japan and Australia and here. It's just something we never thought. And when you do make those accomplishments, I think our record Survivor debuted at number one in 11 countries.
Yeah.
That's huge. That makes it, like, that's even more special than America, just because even though that is very hard in America, to do that, that's a whole nother level. Like, that's there's not many people that can accomplish that, so that means so much to us.
And especially, since you mentioned Survivor, to do all that, a song you wrote in 5 minutes on an airplane.
Yeah.
And I mean, even when you wrote it, did you say to the girls, here's another bloody song, I don't know if this is any good or not, or whatever. And did you need those two to say, that's great, that's
yeah,
good.
I did. I got the track, and when I heard the track, it was so strong, and it just made you feel like a warrior, you know.
Yeah.
And I heard them talking about us on the way to the airport. I said, you know, I'm about to write this song. And when I said, y'all, I wrote a song called Survivor, because it was the whole joke about us being survivors. And I sang it really quiet. I always sing it really quiet, and they can't hear me. They're like, girl, sing it. Why are you scared? But they were like, that is incredible. And there was so much power in the studio. We knew once we recorded it that it was a powerful song.
Yeah.
Cyndi Lauper actually came in the studio because we were doing a special with her. She cried after she heard it. And it was like right after we recorded it. And we knew then that song was powerful.
Now I let you out of my life, I'm so much better. You thought that I'd be weak without you, but I'm stronger. You thought that I'd be broke without you, but I'm richer. You thought that I'd be sad without you, I love harder. Thought I wouldn't grow without you, now I'm wiser. Thought that I'd be helpless without you, but I'm smarter. You thought that I'd be stressed without you, but I'm chilling. You thought I wouldn't sell without you, sold my million.
Because even the book about the band is called Survivor's Story.
Soul Survivors.
Yeah, yeah. Well, okay, but I mean, it's full story. It does use that in the title. The thing is that when you became a trio, was that one of the hardest decisions you ever had to make? But this is where we want to go now. We've been here, a few mistakes here along the way. This is us now.
When we became a trio, that definitely was one of the hardest. Not really so much becoming a trio, but when we replaced members.
That's what I mean.
The trio was very natural. It almost was like second nature, because Charlie's Angels we were about to do, and it was three of them. Vocally, the three of us were so strong. We all were the same height. We all, our personalities got along. It just was like, it was like, why didn't we think of this before? Why did we ever even get four people? Once we met Michelle, we knew it was right. So that wasn't really a hard decision. Finding two members and continuing on as Destiny's Child was really, really the hardest thing. But now that I think about it, it was a hard decision, and it was a lot of hard work, and we got a lot of criticism for it. But if I had to do the same thing, I'd do it again. I'd do it 10 times.
Yeah. But was it helped by the fact that your dad, as manager, was also a dad for Kelly growing up as well, that you two were that close all the way?
Yes. Yes. It definitely puts a special bond when your group members are like family. And Kelly is as much as my sister, my Solange, my blood sister, is my sister. She's been my sister for 11 years. We've shared the same room, the same bathroom, the same clothes, the same everything since I was 9 years old. And she's been like a father. My father and my mother have been like parents. And her mother has, so she has three parents. And it's way deeper than singing on the stage. It's love, and it's real, it's pure, it's sisterhood.
But is she able to also be critical? I mean, did you ever bring a song to her and you say, hey, listen, that's pretty good, isn't it? She says, no, that's no good, I'm not doing that.
When I have some ideas and I sing them, they don't say anything. And I'm like, okay.
You know.
Right. And then I just do something else.
All right.
Or they'll be like, I don't like that.
Yeah. I get the impression that one of the things you like most, I mean, obviously performing on stage is one of the big things, but in terms of producing and arranging and all the rest, you actually like the actual writing of songs.
I actually like the arrangements of the songs better than the writing. I like music. If it was up to me, I'd just sing ooh and all like the whole time and just come up with cool arrangements. That's my favorite.
Yeah. But the most important thing is to try and stay true to who you are, obviously. And I presume that's one of the things your mother would have said to you from the word go. The most important way to live your life is be whoever you are and don't be somebody else. That was easy enough maybe in 97, 98. But down the line now that you've been around a good while, is it still as easy?
Well, who you are changes, you know, with age and with your environment. And I still believe in 90% of the same things. You know, I still have the same friends. I still am the same person. I treat people the same way. But certain things, when you travel the world, your views on certain things open up and you realize things that you didn't know. And especially with age, certain things that you say you never do, certain things you thought you would never like, you like certain, you know, things that your mother did that you said, oh, I hate, you start doing, you know. So definitely we've changed a lot. We've matured a lot. And a lot of things, like I said, that I thought I'd never do, I've done and I enjoy it. So I'm growing and I'm changing. So who I am is forever changing. But basically the same, the core beliefs and the morals and how I treat people and certain things stick with you forever.
Yeah.
If you surround yourself with people that keep you grounded. And you don't have people around you that let you just do whatever you want.
Say my name, no one is around you. Say, baby, I love you, you ain't running game. Say my name, you acting kinda shady. Ain't calling me baby, why the sudden change? Say my name, if no one is around you. Say, baby, I love you, if you ain't running game. Say my name, you acting kinda shady. Ain't calling me baby. Better say my name.
The other day, I would call, you would say, baby, how's your day? But today, it ain't the same. Every other word is a huh, yeah, okay. Could it be that you are at the crib with another lady? If you took it there, first of all, let me say, I am not the one to sit around and be played. So prove yourself to me. I'm the girl that you claim. Why don't you say the things that you said to me yesterday?
The rumors in the industry, the stuff that's written about you guys, at first, was that the hardest thing to get over?
Yeah, definitely.
Is it easier now? Because you realize that people are always going to write complete bull about a band that gets bigger and bigger all the time, and you've got to understand you don't have to believe this stuff.
Yeah, well, it's getting better. It's still hard sometimes. Certain things, I don't even read interviews anymore because there's a certain image of lead singers in girl bands, and it's not just me, it's everyone that's successful. And I don't know if Diana Ross or whoever started this whole image, and even when you're not that, they'll make you that, and it's really irritating to me. I know you gotta sell magazines, but I don't read certain things. Certain things, it's just like, okay, I'm so used to it. It's just, I already expect certain things. But it was very hard for me in the beginning to read things. things about my family and things about my dad and things about me and things about how we get along that ain't true, you know. But I think people now, the more you people see us and the more they meet us, you realize that, you know, certain things are not true. I just hope society believes, I mean, can understand that everything they read is not the truth, you know. You think because you read it in a magazine and it's the Bible, like it's the truth. It was written down, I read it, but you don't realize that anybody can write anything they want.
So do you realize also that you've read magazines from National Enquirer to whatever and
yes,
believe things and realize I shouldn't have believed that?
Yes, that's the definitely. I never judged people, but I was still young and still, for some reason, when you hear things about celebrities, it's very entertaining to you because you don't think they're normal people. Now, I don't read that gossip stuff about anybody. They know already not to come with me with that. They know, girl, did you?
Yeah.
I don't want to hear that. Because first of all, how do you know? How do you know that that's true? How do you know that that wasn't made up? It could be made up just like it was made up about me because I've been judged, so I don't judge other people.
So should a lot of us listen to the song Happy Face and realize that's where you're coming from in many ways?
Yeah, Happy Face, definitely. I was really stressed because I was during the time where I heard so many rumors. And I woke up and the window was open and the sun just shined me in my eye and it was the most beautiful day outside. And I said, I was crying all night, cried myself to sleep. That's when I realized, why am I sad about this? Why am I concentrating on these small people that believe this when there are millions of other people that don't? If not, we wouldn't have all these people at our concert screaming. I wouldn't have people sending all these fan letters. Why am I concentrating on this? There's way more positive things to concentrate on.
The fact that you talk openly about loving God, do you find you get stick from that? And do you find, what's wrong with these people? This is what we do. Is it like, or do you get stick?
Some people don't understand it. Some people don't understand, you know, especially here, they don't understand that Christianity is a way of life. It's not a way you dress, or it's not what you say. It's how you live your life and your personal relationship with God. And some people will think, you know, like I've gotten slack for acknowledging God for the gift of writing songs. And they say, if you write Bootylicious, how can you thank God for that? And I don't feel like God wrote Bootylicious, but I do feel like God gave me the gift to write songs, to connect with people that may not know God, and maybe I have to sing Bootylicious to connect with them so they can hear the gospel medley on the album.
Kelly, can you handle this? Michelle, can you handle this? Beyonce, can you handle this?
Bit of like a big movie like an Austin Powers then. I mean, is that scarier than like, does Carmen seem easy in comparison?
Well, when I did Carmen, I was just as scared.
Yeah, right.
Now that I look at it, it wasn't as much pressure. But then, no, it was because it was my first time acting. And if I would have did a horrible job, I wouldn't have gotten Austin Powers because Carmen is what got me Austin Powers. So it was what opened the doors for me. So it was very important. It doesn't matter what it is. When you start a new chapter in your life, everything is just scary. It's a good scariness because it forces you to grow. My main thing is performing by myself. Like, I can't imagine that. That's why in our show a year ago, we started doing one song by ourselves just so we can get comfortable with that because we knew after the tour we would start individual projects. And all of us were horrified. We were all scared. We wanted to do it, but it's just scary. So we said, okay, maybe we should use this tour and each do a song by ourselves. And the first couple times, I forgot the words. And I did not have Kelly and Michelle on the stage to look at, because every night I forget words to some song. Yeah. And they weren't there, so I would have to make up new words or just some kind of way deal with it, which now I'm more comfortable. But you have to grow, and it is a scary thing.
Yeah, okay, but what about more acting? I mean, you've said, I think, somewhere in the past that you would like to do more and maybe get a bit raw and down and dirty next time around. Mm-hmm. Like, for instance, I don't know, maybe a Halle Berry kind of thing of, like, total emotions of Beyoncé up there on the screen, as mm-hmm. opposed to what you've done before. Is that what you would like to do next?
Yeah. I've always been a fan of Lady Sings the Blues and Mahogany.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I think maybe that's why I want to do that, because Diana Ross did such a great job. And she was so emotional and so dramatic, and I love that.
But that would really mess with your head over a period of 3 or 6 months. Would you be prepared for that? Like, you go, like, Diana Ross.
I know.
Took a few years to get out of that, you know?
I know, because even being Foxy Cleopatra or even being Carmen, it took me, and I was only Carmen for a month and a half. It took me about 3 months to get out of that. I was like doing things I wouldn't do. I was aggressive, and it was real strange. And Foxy, I'm just now starting to talk like me. I was still talking like Foxy Cleopatra